Hey, I'm Nick Breeze.
And I'm John Satram.
And we run an event series called Dream, or Data Rules Everything Around Me, presented by Mozilla in partnership with Next.
You know, it's an amazing time to be a user. Our feeds are curated to our every interest. Our recommendations are spot on, and even our shopping carts are auto-magically filled with our every need and desire.
As we've been lulled into our data bubbles, our machines have been listening to us, and they're understanding us, and they're learning a lot from us.
Today, a subset of AI known as machine learning is totally changing the way we create algorithms. Traditionally, programmers would hand code rules to solve specific tasks, but with machine learning, what you do is you create a generalized structure, like an artificial neural network, which is capable of solving different tasks. The way you get that generalized algorithm to do something specific is through a process called training. There's different ways to do this, but it usually involves feeding the algorithm lots of data, often data that's been labeled and organized by people. During the training process, the algorithm identifies patterns in the data, and when it's done learning, what results is a model, a trained machine learning algorithm. And these usually always outperform the traditional algorithms.
With these new processes come new ethical quagmires and questions, which is why we sat down with Margaret Mitchell to talk about the current landscape of AI and ML and some of the unique challenges that it presents. She runs the Ethical Artificial Intelligence team in Google's Research and Machine Intelligence Group.
These days, working on the ethics part of AI is still a bit of a niche. Most folks in the field prefer to work on some of the cutting-edge applications, like creating the best self-driving car or the best virtual assistant. But this technology is moving very fast and breaking a lot of things in our society, and this is having a lot of unintended side effects.
Yeah, imagine the cops coming to your door to tell you that they're watching you just because of your social network.
Which is something that happens.
Or imagine getting charged a higher price for the type of device that you use, or your zip code, or your skin color.
Which is also a thing that has happened.
It seems like the worst parts of society are being embedded throughout the entire AI pipeline, reinforcing old stereotypes and amplifying our biases.
It doesn't have to be that way. That's just kind of a groupthink mentality. One very clear example right now is in the case of face detection. The technology tends to work a lot better for white males than it does for black women. When you have developers who are largely white males, they might not even notice looking at a data set that it's missing black females. It's a sort of cascade of different kinds of biases and errors that down the whole pipeline can lead to technology that works only for some people and can misidentify other kinds of people, or in some cases, like if we're talking about predictive policing, or falsely give the sense that certain subgroups of people are a lot more likely to make crimes and things like that, when that's not actually true. It's reflecting the biases of previous police officers who had previously made arrests, as opposed to where crimes had actually been committed. And often this corresponds to people who are historically marginalized or face a lot of discrimination already. So it's just sort of making the situation worse. If you just sort of release things broadly without giving a sort of understanding of the breakdown of these kinds of errors, then as APIs get released, as things are just sort of generally made available, people have a sense, oh, this works. It exists, and thus it works. One of the things that I've put forth with a bunch of collaborators is called model cards, where the idea is that you don't release a model without details about how well it works. You have this for cars, you have this for medication, it's just a normal thing to do. The model cards framework is an attempt to put forth disaggregated evaluation, which is breaking down how well the system works in terms of different kinds of subgroups. And it's really important to sort of make that clear if you're going to release a face detection system so people know when it can be used and when it can't be used. And then in addition to that, details about the data sets, how was the data collected, who were the annotators, where were they from, were they paid, what were their incentives, all of the various sources of bias, all of the various sources of skews that then go into a final product that can have all these different kinds of errors reflecting the whole pipeline that brought it there. There's been an uptick in research on what's been called debiasing or unbiasing, but you find that a lot of that bias that you debiased just comes right back. You have to see color to see discrimination, like this kind of thing. Like if you just pretend it's not there, that doesn't make it go away. Some of the work I've done has been focusing on what we've been calling inclusion in machine learning, which is adding in representations for things that otherwise might be missed. And then you can create models that can sort of reflect those normative values by adding in representations for things. There's all kinds of human biases, and the more you work on this stuff, the more you realize that all we are is basically a collection of biases, and we sort of get through the world using our sort of general heuristics and rules of thumbs. But by noticing that this is something we're doing, by actually going out of your way in some cases to make sure that the people who come, that the people who are interviewed, the people who are part of the projects are women, are people of color, then from the start you have technology that's being developed in light of a variety of different life experiences and a variety of different priorities. It's up to individuals who work on this stuff to speak out about the kinds of things that they think are important. And from there, you can start creating strategies that fundamentally change what kind of problems are worked on, or how things are developed, or whether or not things are launched. And be real about this. Like, people are racist, people are sexist, and our models are learning this. They're learning prejudice and stereotypes. And we're in this position now where we can put in our normative constraints, what we want the models to behave like. But as more and more people start using these things and the technology gets more and more embedded in further products, it gets harder and harder to understand where the biases are coming from. So I think we're really at a turning point right now to be very clear about how we want our models to behave and working on approaches that sort of best fit those desires.